Hello everyone, welcome to another YouTube video. Well, it's an emotional moment, well, big moment, at least for the next three and a half years until I make another James Bond film. But this is indeed the very last James Bond review video, number 25. I just thought I'd make a little clip here at the start. You have to see my face in one of these videos. Just say, I guess thank you really, you know, sticking with the series, you know, watching the series. I mean, James Bond has really been kicking my channel forward this year. I mean, I've just hit 7 subscribers, and it's been thanks to partly the series, of course, which is really, really nice. The series has in total gained around something around I think about 3,500 views. It's been really, really great how many views and brought in these likes and new viewers to the channel, and some other things about not just James Bond film reviews, like the DVD and the Aston Martin and other things will be coming in the future. So yeah, thank you all so much for watching the series, and for the last time, at least for now, yeah, enjoy the review. Here we get Bond film number 25, 2021, No Time to Die, the latest Bond film released. The beginning of this Bond film was very much that follow-up to Spectre. We know all about Madeleine's past, of course, the masked man shooting her mother, and of course, who killed her father. But of course, again, we also know from Spectre, she took out the gun from underneath the sink, and she used that to shoot, this masked man is Safin. And he shoots him, he falls off the stairs, and it seemed as if all is done and he is dead. But as she is pulling his body out, we of course learn that he is indeed still alive. And he chases her, and we think he's probably going to kill her, but he actually doesn't. He actually just rescues her, and he then jumps back into the next section of the pre-title sequence, which is very, very nice actually. It's the section where James Bond is with, goes back to Vesper's grave, so of course, you know, linking all the 5 Daniel Craig Bond films together. And the explosion there is very, very neat. No, that wasn't actually in the trailer, so none of the audience actually saw it coming. However, what is followed is something we did see in the trailer, so the most audience was coming, which was, of course, the jump off the bridge. But again, it's very, very good. All very good stunt stuff. I mean, it's been, of course, that 6-year gap. It's even something about a month longer or two than between Lightning and GoldenEye, between 89 and 95. It's a pretty big gap, but of course, it's very good. You know, the James Bond film, they're very much still alive. He jumps off the bridge, and then the motorbike chase follows, and again, it's just very, very good stuff. Yeah, it's really, really good. James Bond, of course, steals them that, well, I don't really know his exact name, just kind of that crazy eyeball man, and he kills him. But of course, the eyeball man informs them that Blofeld is indeed still alive. But he also informs that Madeleine is actually working for Spectre, but it's later known to be a cover story, but of course it makes his mind think that this might be like Vesper all over again. So we thought this could be something to Skyfall, you know, that motorbike chase, but indeed it's not. It's just kind of just a short commute between there and the hotel. A little bit underwhelming, but I mean, it still works. And the next scene, of course, is very, very good with the Aston Martin DB5 making another return. So a car chasing follows. Again, this is still the pre-title sequence. It's the longest pre-title sequence out of all of the James Bond films, but it definitely fits that, and it's completely fine. So James Bond is then cornered by the villains, but we then get probably the Aston Martin DB5's best moment ever, with of course the machine guns and the bulletproof glass as they're all shooting. And it seems as if James Bond's about to give up, he feels pretty defeated. But indeed, there is still some hope left in him. Of course, the title of the film is No Time to Die, although we learn at the end of the film that isn't quite the case. Then he turns on, of course, the machine guns, and it is just absolutely incredible what happens next. I mean, that stunt work, of course, probably a bit of CGI there, the bullets coming out, but even so, it's absolutely amazing. We then get a more, as James Bond, of course, he needs to go to the Spectre meeting and then find out about what the villains are all doing and who's working for Spectre. And he goes to get into his classic tuxedo. This is the black tuxedo. So it's very good, you know, linking the old Bond with the new, which is all about No Time to Die. I mean, it's very reminiscent of Her Majesty's Secret Service from 1969. 52 years previously, when his film was released. The actual end bit of the film, the end credits, does play Louis Armstrong's We Have All the Time in the World, so that's a very, very nice. So it seemed if in the scene James Bond is about to be completely killed off, as you know, all of Spectre are there, but indeed not, because the person working for them is actually not working for Spectre. Of course, later learn he's working for Safin, and he basically uses these nanobots to kill everyone but James Bond. He codes their DNA, which is very interesting way of murder, but also, I don't know, does this technology actually exist in real life? If so, that's actually quite scary. Nevertheless, James Bond does find out that, of course, that person, right, Logan Ash, was, lying to them and just telling all Spectre what they were actually doing. So he ends up taking the gun, shooting James Bond, and Felix Leiter makes a return for the first time ever with another character, which, well, no, yeah, again, making a return as Felix Leiter. And it's pretty sad, really, because, of course, we're going to be seeing License to Kill in 1989, 22 years previously, that Felix can get injured and have his moments in the Bond films, but in this film, well, he dies, and it's honestly quite emotional the way he dies. I mean, the boat's getting flooded, there seems no hope, and he kind of just gives up and he stays there. So yeah, audiences weren't really expecting that. Personally, killing off Felix Leiter I think is allowed, but killing off James Bond is not allowed. We'll get to that later. And again, the thing about, he thinks about Vespa, because of course she also died in a water-related incident. So we then get the masked man revealed to, of course, be this man, Vespin, who is Safin, who is honestly really good acting from him. I mean, I've only ever known this actor from the Night of the Museum films, but no, in this film he is absolutely incredible. The acting is very good. He seems so sinister and dark, but also there's like a light side to him. It's really quite interesting. I mean, his one goal is just to kill Madeline, really, since her father killed his family. There isn't too much of the Q branch in this film, though they are all still returning characters. What probably, again, another bit of shot this film is that James Bond, although Madeline denies it, of course, we all know it is, James Bond has a daughter called Mathilde. That is actually her name in real life. That isn't just that's actually the actor's name, who is also, I think she's quite good for it. She's only like, what, 5-6 years old. But yeah, adds something new to the film. I mean, personally, James Bond having a daughter doesn't really sit completely right with me, but in this film's case, it does kind of work. Because, well, I mean, like, say, I don't know, like Goldfinger, you wouldn't expect his daughter to be there carrying the gold bars, do you know what I mean? It's like that, but in this film it does work to an extent. And of course, another thing, of course, Niobe here, who is playing 007, because James Bond retired, which makes it pretty clear 007 is just a number. However, at the end credit it does say James Bond will return, so it will probably be a man who's James Bond. Well, Q Bright manages to, of course, MI6, sorry, manages to inform James Bond that Logan Ash is coming, so he manages to drive off, but unfortunately they realise that's him driving off, and the cars quickly chase after them. And this is probably the main acting for the film, in terms of the cars at least. It's very, very good, actually. I mean, it's really quite intense, stunt work, and all very, very well written and done. It's taken ages to get all the shots right. But the end result is Safin take Mathilde and what's her name? It just escaped my mind. Madeline. Why did that take so long for me to remember? It takes them away, and then we get to the climax of the film, which I jump straight to. It doesn't really need an introduction, does it? And honestly, well, where do we really begin? I mean, as we see here, the mission's done. He manages to kill Safin, like any other villain. But he chooses, because of course he was infected by nanobots. Now if he touches Mathilde or Madeline, they will die. Quite horribly, of course, like we just saw previously. But honestly, it's just, I don't know, it's just, he's James Bond, he doesn't give up. He always finds a way. Even if at the end we saw him, I don't know, pull out that Thunderball rocket jetpack thing, you know, from the pre-time, even that would make more sense than him dying. He can't die, James Bond. I mean, the way he just gives up, I mean, I would understand he's got a disease and everything, and, you know, the nanobots are going to kill him, but he could easily have just, you know, be like that, you know, like the Skittles advert, man, and just not touch anything. But so, yeah, it's pretty sad, really, you know. Because, like I said, I mean, this came out at the end of 2021, so we're going into 2022, the, you know, the 60th anniversary Diamond Jubilee of Bond films with just a dead Bond. It's just, yeah, I don't think it's good. I mean, you wouldn't really think someone like Roger Moore would do this, would you? Or Sean Connery just giving up and dying, or even George Lazenby giving up and dying. So, yeah, it, but, I mean, it does, of course, allow the next James Bond to just kind of go wherever it wants. You know, Specs is defeated, Safin's defeated, James Bond's been called off. But yeah, it's, although it is a in the way of fitting end to this series I'm making it, of course, it ends you with a close. So thank you all so much for watching. I've really enjoyed making this series of the James Bond reviews over the past year. Don't go anywhere. You can still turn notifications and subscribe to the channel, since I will still be making James Bond themed videos. But until then, thank you all so much for watching, and goodbye.